friends, and welcome to another broadcast of A Heart After God Bible Teaching Ministry. This is Brad Abley, and I'm just about ready to get into part two of the parable of the wheat and the tares. I'm teaching from Matthew chapter 13, beginning in verse 24. If you have your Bible with you, would you please turn with me to Matthew 13 and verse 24. Again, this is part two of the parable of the wheat and the tares. And if you're following along in the notes that I provided for you on my website, then I'm picking up at paragraph number 49 in the notes. However, in this particular, well, in part one, I really didn't follow the notes like I normally would, and so I didn't repeat paragraph after paragraph. I'm probably not going to do that in this video as well. Nevertheless, if you do want to try to follow along in the notes, you can pick up on paragraph number 49 of my teaching on a parable of the wheat and the tares. So we're beginning in Matthew chapter 13 and verse 24. Of course, before we begin, we need to pray. And so if you'll join me in prayer, Heavenly Father, we ask now that you would open our hearts and open our eyes and our ears to learn from you. And we invite you, Holy Spirit, to come and lead us and guide us in your truth. Change us and transform us so that we become more like you, Lord Jesus, is our prayer in your name. Amen and amen. Well, we've already read through the parable, but because this is part two, I'd like to read over it again. And so if you'll follow along with me in Matthew 13, beginning in verse 24, Jesus presented another parable to them, saying, "The kingdom of heaven may be compared to a man who sowed good seed in his field." Remember that we taught extensively on what the kingdom of heaven is, and how the parables really bring out the very nature of the kingdom of heaven, the kingdom of God. And so he says, "The kingdom of heaven may be compared to a man who sowed good seed in his field. But while his men were sleeping, his enemy came and sowed tares among the wheat and went away." Verse 26, "But when the wheat sprouted and bore grain, then the tares became evident also. The slaves of the landowner came and said to him, 'Sir, did you not sow good seed in your field? How then does it have tares?' And he said to them, 'An enemy has done this.' The slaves said to him, 'Do you want us then to go and gather them up?' But he said, 'No, for while you are gathering up the tares, you may uproot the wheat with them.'" And verse 30, "Allow both to grow together until the harvest, and in the time of the harvest, I will say to the reapers, 'First, gather up the tares and bind them in bundles to burn them up, but gather the wheat into my barn.'" And as we noticed last time, Jesus goes on and gives, he goes on to give two more very brief parables. And then it's in verse 36 where Matthew picks up and he says, "Then he left the crowds and went into the house." That is the home where he lived throughout most of his Galilean ministry in Capernaum, which is just, you could walk to the Sea of Galilee in, I don't know, a minute or two. It's that close to the shore of the Sea of Galilee. And so Matthew tells us he went into the house, and his disciples came to him and said, "Explain to us the parable of the tares of the field." And we learned last time that they were in effect commanding him. It's not that they were commanding him, but that's the tense of the verb. It's in the imperative voice, but it was more of a sense of urgency. Make thoroughly clear right now the meaning of this parable. And so it the urgency of their question shows just how much the parable of this of the wheat and the tares shook them. And so in verse 37, he said, "The one who sows the good seed is the Son of Man, and the field is the world." We established last time that it's not the church, it's the world. It's the preaching of the gospel out into the world. It's the word of God that goes out into the world. "And as for the good seed, these are the sons of the kingdom," that is, believers in Jesus Christ in every sphere of society, bring forth the shining example through their lives of the king, the nature of the kingdom of heaven or the kingdom of God. So the sons, he says, the good seed, these are the sons of the kingdom, and the tares are the sons of the evil one. And the enemy who sowed them is the devil, and the harvest is the end of the age. So Jesus is teaching that there is going to be, there's an expiration date, if you will, of this present evil age. It's going to end, and then the kingdom of God will come in its fullness. And then he says, the reapers are angels. Verse 40, "So just as the tares are gathered up and burned with fire, so it shall be at the end of the age." That's the second time he's repeated that. Verse 41, "The Son of Man will send forth his angels, and they will gather out of his kingdom all stumbling blocks and those who commit lawlessness," that is, on a continuous basis, "and will throw them into the furnace of fire. In that place, there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth." And then he concludes the parable with these words in verse 43, "Then the righteous will shine forth as the sun in the kingdom of their Father." And then he ends this with this, it's both a cryptic statement and it's a sober exhortation. "He who has ears, let him hear." It's a present, it's in the present tense, it's in the imperative voice. And so Jesus is saying, listen, learn to hear the word of God and hear it with a good heart, as he taught in the parable of the sower, and keep on hearing the word of God as well. Well, so this parable really shows us that the enemy sows bad seed among good seed. That's really what Satan is doing everything he can to hinder the growth of the kingdom of God, to resist it, to oppose it, to undermine it, to destroy it if he can, which he can't, but that's, he thinks he can. And while the kingdom of God is larger than the church, it's greater than the church, even a perfect church can never escape trouble. And that's one of the benefits of this parable to the Church of Jesus Christ, is to recognize that in this age, a perfect church is unattainable. Why? Because the devil is also working to undermine the church, which advances the kingdom of God. And he's working to undermine the kingdom of God. And so he's doing everything he can through false teaching, ungodly behavior, competing philosophies, and many more things like this. Now, by understanding the parable, leaders of the church and all Christians, we can prepare ourselves ahead of time for conflict, for sorrow, for betrayal and disappointment from others, and hold firm in the face of it all. We have to have a realistic perspective about the battle for the souls of men. But listen, we must also keep in mind that we have no jurisdiction now over men's souls, and therefore we are never to attempt to root out anyone that we might suspect as being tares. For example, if you'll turn with me, hold your place in Matthew 13, and turn with me to Luke chapter 9, Luke chapter 9 and verse 51. Luke 9 and verse 51. So, Luke tells us, Luke 9 verse 51, when the days were approaching for his ascension, that is, of course, back into heaven, he was determined to go to Jerusalem. And he sent messengers on ahead of him, and they went and entered a village of the Samaritans to make arrangements for him. But when they did not receive him, excuse me, that is the Samaritans, because he was traveling toward Jerusalem, Verse 54, but when his disciples James and John saw this, they said, Lord, do you want us to command fire to come down from heaven and consume them? Well, James and John certainly had a lot of faith that they could do exactly what Elijah did. But Jesus turned, verse 55, and rebuked them and said, you do not know what kind of spirit you are of. For the Son of Man did not come to destroy men's lives, but to save them. And they went on to another village. Well, it looks to me in some sense that the disciples, James and John, certainly needed to hear the parable of the wheat and the tares, because when they saw at face value people not following him, they were indignant, no doubt, of course, and they didn't understand the mercy of God. They didn't understand the patience of God to work towards those who reject him over and over and over and over again, that at some point these people actually might come to faith in him, in Jesus. One commentator, Alfred Plummer, makes this comment. He says, the Messiah here repeats the lesson. Plummer is writing a commentary on Luke, and of Luke 9, 51 through 56, he writes this comment. He says, the Messiah here repeats the lesson. Judgment is mine, not man's. And though the divine judgment never fails, yet it does tarry. That's an old English word that means it waits. It's patient. And it is the divine patience that man must strive to imitate. Man is short-lived and is often hasty. He who is from everlasting to everlasting can afford to wait. Now, someone is certainly wondering, well, what about church discipline? Well, the truth is that we do bring church discipline for those who claim to be Christians, but who refuse to repent of their sin. One great passage about church discipline is in Matthew 18, verses 16 through 18. If you'll turn with me there to Matthew 18, again, hold your place in Matthew 13, because we're going to go back to the parable of the wheat and the tares. But let's go to Matthew 18, and we're going to look at verses 16 through 18. Here's church discipline given by Jesus himself. And so he says, I'm sorry, let's go back to verse 15 of Matthew 18. If your brother sins, go and show him his fault in private. If he listens to you, you have won your brother. And of course, the whole idea there is not to condemn this man, but to have the heart of redemption. But, verse 16, if he does not listen to you, take one or two more with you, so that by the mouth of two or three witnesses, every fact may be confirmed. If he refuses to listen to them, tell it to the church. That is, to bring it to the entire church. And if he refuses to listen even to the church, let him be to you as a Gentile and a tax collector. That tells us that the offending sinner has got an extremely hard heart because he's been given a number of chances to repent. And then if you'll turn with me as well to Romans chapter 16, this is another very important passage about church discipline. Romans chapter 16. Church leaders can never allow the attitude of, the old Doris Day song, Que sera, sera, whatever will be. There is no such thing as an anything goes attitude in the church. Church leaders and all Christians must uphold biblical, righteous, godly standards. We are all sinners. We all need to repent, I would argue, on a daily basis. But we also have to be accountable to one another. And so with that, the Apostle Paul tells the church in Rome, and he's speaking not just to the leaders, but to the whole church, in Romans 16, verse 17, he says, "Now I urge you, brethren, keep your eye," present infinitive, that is, habitually, "keep your eye on those who cause dissensions and hindrances contrary to the teaching which you learned, and turn away from them." The Greek word to keep your eye on means to be exceedingly particular about, to get acquainted with, to search out, to scrutinize. He says, keep your eye on those who cause dissensions or divisions. They're there. That the church is always going to have those. And the enemy is working as well. Satan is called the devil. Diabolos in Greek means slanderer. And so, but the Roman church is being exhorted by Paul to watch out for those who cause dissensions habitually and hindrances contrary to the teaching which you learned. Hindrances, the Greek word is where we get our word scandal from. We're going to talk about that a little bit later. It means to cause offense. It means to cause someone to stumble. And he says, watch out for these people that do things contrary to the teaching which you learned, and turn away from them, to come away from them, to shun them, to avoid them. For such men, verse 18, are slaves, not of our Lord Jesus Christ, but of their own appetites. And by their smooth and flattering speech, they deceive the hearts of the unsuspecting. By their smooth and flattering speech, it's speech that seems plausible, it seems accurate, it seems logical or rational, it seems fair, but there's always something that they're insinuating to try to turn people away from what is good and right. He says, contrary to the teaching which you learned. Flattering speech can be praiseworthy speech, fine speaking, well chosen, but it's untrue. And then Paul says, they deceive the hearts of the unsuspecting. And so it's important, indeed it's imperative, for all Christians to know the Word of God well, to know what it says, and to stand against those that would try to bring confusion or destruction in the body of Christ. Now, one other outstanding verse that we should know well on church discipline comes in Titus chapter 3. If you'll turn with me to Titus chapter 3, you get 1 Thessalonians, 2 Thessalonians, 1 Timothy, 2 Timothy, and then Titus chapter 3, where Paul says, reject a factious man, that is someone that is causing dissension, after a first and a second warning. The first warning presumably would be taking along someone with you, and then the second warning being taking it to the whole church, knowing that such a man is perverted and is sinning, being self-condemned. So there is a scriptural warrant for church discipline. But that's not what the parable of the wheat and the tares is all about. The parable of the wheat and the tares is dealing with non-Christian people and God giving them time to repent. So our Lord's warning against his own people who cannot see into the hearts of men, attempting to root out the tares from the wheat, which is what Jesus' servants wanted to do, would serve notice to the church throughout history against trying to usurp God's jurisdiction over the hearts of men. Now, this happened, for example, in the 16th and 17th centuries in Europe, when Roman Catholics and Reformed Christians, that is, followers of Martin Luther and John Calvin and Zwingli and other leading reformers, they severely persecuted a group of Christians called the Anabaptists, what today would be evangelical believers, who believe, generally speaking, in man's free will, to be saved, as a response to the grace and faith that are given to them in the preaching of the gospel. They would say, I would be one of them, that man still has free will and the choice to repent or not to repent. Now, let me read this again. The Anabaptists, again, they would be called, by and large, evangelical believers today. They persecuted them because of their conviction against infant baptism. And they held a firm conviction against the church uniting its power with the state, seeing them as one and the same. The Anabaptists did not agree with that, as the Roman Catholics and the Reformed believers did. And so the Anabaptists were severely persecuted. They believed that they believed in what some would call believer's baptism. That is, that the only true baptism is when someone knows what they're doing, they give their lives to Jesus, and then they're baptized in response to their salvation. They could be young children, but they're making the decision on their own. And the Reformed believers hated that because they believe in infant baptism, so do the Roman Catholics. So over something that is ultimately not an essential of the faith, they persecuted, the Roman Catholics and the Reformed Christians persecuted the Anabaptists severely. They viewed them as heretics, and they were officially outlawed. And their enemies often executed them by drowning, which was kind of a play on terms. In effect, they were saying, all right, you wanted adult baptism? You just got it. We're gonna send you to your judgment by baptizing you in water. They would have believed that they were going to hell. Now, on a different note, it is always possible for someone who is not right with God to turn to him with a good heart, provided an unwise Christian does not come along and do or say something that would permanently offend the person. Again, if you'll hold your place in Matthew 13, turn with me to Luke chapter 17. Luke 17 and verses 1 and 2. Jesus said to his disciples, it is inevitable that stumbling blocks will come, but woe to him through whom they come. Jesus is saying, much like he's teaching in the parable of the wheat and the tares, offenses will come. Scandals will come. You can't stop that. But let it never come through a believer in Jesus Christ, and especially those who are called to full-time pulpit ministry, or to pulpit ministry at all, I should say. He says, but woe to him through whom they come. Verse 2, it would be better for him if a millstone were hung around his neck and he were thrown into the sea than that he would cause one of these little ones to stumble. Now, I've been on three occasions, I've been privileged and blessed to lead three trips to Israel, and I've stood in Capernaum right next to a millstone, which probably was around in Jesus' time, and this millstone weighs, I estimate, maybe a ton. It's huge, and a donkey was tied to a top wheel, if you will, over the millstone, and the donkey would walk around the millstone and crush grain, or olives could be crushed in this thing as well. And the one that is in Capernaum, right by where Jesus' home was, is, again, it's literally just a short walk to the Sea of Galilee. So I can imagine him standing at that millstone, looking at his disciples, looking at the Sea of Galilee, looking back at them again and saying, if you ever cause anyone to stumble away from me, it would be better if we took the rope that was attached to the stick that's attached to the donkey and wrapped it around your neck and threw this thing into the Sea of Galilee, which, of course, obviously, the person would sink and drown. That's how seriously Jesus takes any Christian from causing someone else to stumble to the point where they spend eternity in hell away from God. Now, it is possible for a person who has refused to surrender his or her life to Jesus for an entire lifetime to repent just before death. It happens all the time. So many people, upon facing death and hearing the gospel given one last time, they do repent. I was able to lead my own dad to faith in Jesus Christ shortly after he was told that he had 6 months to live. And by God's grace, I went into his hospital room and I said to him, Dad, I am not leaving this room until you have given your life to Jesus Christ. And I was able to share the gospel with him for an entire half hour when my dad was very high strung and it was very difficult. It was exceedingly difficult to have a conversation with him that lasted more than 5 minutes. And I tried to share the gospel with him on numerous occasions, but I was rebuffed every time. And of course, he saw my life change, but he had hardened his heart. It took a coming catastrophe for him to, lying in that hospital bed, have nowhere else, figuratively speaking, but to look up and be ready to receive Jesus as his Lord and Savior. And by God's grace, a half an hour after I started sharing the gospel with him, he prayed the sinner's prayer with me, gave his life to Jesus. His life changed significantly. And God actually gave him 2 more years to live. And in that salvation, my dad's heart was changed so much that he reconciled with my mom. They had never been divorced, but they really did not have much of a marriage most of my life. And God did a miracle of reconciliation in their lives. So you see, the parable and the wheat and the tares, I mean, my dad belonged to the devil almost all of his life. He was an alcoholic. He cursed all the time. He just was not, in many ways, let me just say, he wasn't born again. Let's put it that way. And he belonged to Satan's kingdom. But in God's mercy, he saved my dad from an eternity in hell. I'm thankful for the parable of the wheat and the tares for that reason. So, beloved, our Lord is educating his people that while the kingdom grows and advances, it will never be free from difficulty. Period. End of story. And if we think that the kingdom of God is not going to be free from difficulty, we are biblically illiterate and biblically, woefully biblically ignorant. And this is what his own disciples witnessed in the way people turned away from Jesus and in the way that they turned away from their preaching as well. Listen, men rebel against God, and Satan is alive and active. That's what the New Testament teaches. Listen, even Jesus was chiefly opposed by Satan and Satan's own useful idiots, I call them, seen primarily in opposition to Jesus from the religious people, and the ultimate indifference to him from the multitudes. Now, Jesus' explanation of the parable is straightforward. We've seen that. But we should also note his main emphasis, seen three times in verses 39, 40, and then 42 through 43. If you look with me in the parable again, Matthew 13 and verse 39, he speaks of the end of the age. He says, "And the enemy who sowed them is the devil, and the harvest is the end of the age, and the reapers are angels." Notice with me again in verse 40. He says, "So just as the tares are gathered up and burned with fire, so shall it be at the end of the age." He's repeating the end of the age for the second time. And then also in verse 43, there's a similar phrase. "Then the righteous will shine forth as the sun in the kingdom of their Father." Jesus is referring in an indirect way to the end of the age. That is, there is going to be a judgment. This current age that we're living in is going to have an end. And that end will be seen in his judgment. The end of the age, probably at the end of the thousand-year reign of Jesus, since Satan is let out of the abyss at the end of this period, then will bring in or usher in the final judgment. Now, the disciples may be encouraged that those who reject their message and the Messiah will one day have a day of reckoning. Jesus has taught this, and then you can see some of my other references in my notes from Daniel chapter 12, verses 2 and 3, and from 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, verses 7 through 9. Again, speaking of the end of the age. However, his faithful ones, by contrast, will enjoy eternal reward. Again, I've got verses here, references for you in Daniel 12, and then in Revelation 2 and in Revelation 5. His faithful ones, by contrast, will enjoy eternal reward, watch this, without any more interference or attacks from Satan and his people, from his emissaries. And we can see that in Revelation 20, verses 1 through 10. Now, it might be surprising to see angels inflicting punishment in verses 41 and 42, but the same scene appears later in Matthew 24, verses 30 and 31. And as well in Revelation 14, 18 through 20. Now, I mentioned a little bit ago the Greek word scandal. Jesus warned about those who cause stumbling blocks. In verse 41, he says, the Son of Man at the end of the age will send forth his angels, and they will gather out of his kingdom. Jesus is not teaching that they entered into the kingdom of God, but all people are really, whether they realize it or not, they are, in a sense, they are in the kingdom of God. Let me put it a different way. The kingdom of God rules over the affairs of men. But because this age is also a present evil age, Paul says, because Satan is that outlaw spirit in the kingdom, in the earth, that means that people are, they're really, in a sense, under the authority, I guess you could say, that would probably be the best way to explain it. People are under God's authority, though they rebel against it. You can be a citizen of the United States, you can be a citizen of Kenya, but you can still rebel against the laws of those societies. You can be put in prison, but you're still in effect a citizen, although you're a rebellious citizen. And at some point, just depending on the laws of different countries, you can be expelled from the country and lose your citizenship. Well, people are going to lose out for eternity at the end of the age. And so in Matthew 13, verse 41, Jesus says, the Son of Man will send forth his angels, and they will gather out of his kingdom all stumbling blocks and those who commit lawlessness. Now, the Greek word stumbling block comes from, the Greek word to stumble is skandalizo, and that's where we get our word scandal from. Now, depending upon the context and the verbal tense of the word, scandalizo can mean to cause offense in the active sense, or in the passive sense, it can mean to take offense at. In the passive tense, it can also mean to fall away from. And Jesus, as I've already gone over with you, Jesus has already shown his disciples that if they're not careful, they could cause someone to turn away from him. There, another reference for that is Matthew 18, verses 1 through 6. And yet, in the very next verse, Jesus is also warning unbelievers against doing the same thing. In fact, if you'll turn with me to Matthew 18, just a few chapters away from Matthew 13, again, hold your place in Matthew 13. But let's look at Matthew 18. In verse 7 of Matthew 18, Jesus says, woe to the world because of its stumbling blocks. For it is inevitable that stumbling blocks come, but woe to that man through whom the stumbling block comes. So the warning goes out not just to his disciples, but to all people. Now, there are many, 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 many people in the world who hate God and who actively persecute God's people and who actively are trying to scandalize people away from the kingdom of God, away from salvation. And if those people don't repent, there is going to be a very special judgment of God awaiting them throughout eternity. And, you know, especially when you're dealing with the eternal souls of men. So when Jesus warns like that, and when he says, woe, that is a term of expressing grief, because he knows precisely what the end of such people will be like. Now, scandalizo also has the idea of setting traps for people, and is used here of the devil's children who work against God and try to cause as many people as possible to fall away from him. Now, those who commit lawlessness, Jesus says, he will gather back to Matthew 13, verse 41, that the angels will gather out of his kingdom all stumbling blocks and those who commit lawlessness. Describes the permanent condition of all apart from Jesus Christ. And then he says in verse 42, he says that the angels will throw them into the furnace of fire. In that place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. The Greek word weeping refers to loud crying or wailing, and gnashing is a grinding of the teeth. It was used as an expression of anger and frustration of the damned. You know, I think of the people in Hollywood, for example, that that make movies or make television programs and mock Jesus Christ and mock the gospel and mock his people, they have tremendous power. They have tremendous influence. They know that. They are extremely wealthy. And as they work to turn people against God, you know, they may get what they want in this lifetime, but when they answer to God for what they've done throughout eternity, they will be weeping and gnashing their teeth because of the judgment of God against them. University professors that mock Christianity, that mock Jesus followers, that mock Scripture. Scientists, other people in society that use a public platform to excoriate Christianity and to undermine the message of the gospel, they have a frightful judgment awaiting them. I pray that somehow this teaching gets to one of you, and that in God's grace and mercy, your eyes would be opened, your heart would be broken, and that you would recognize that you have offended a holy God, a holy righteous judge, who, because of his love for you, has not destroyed you yet. And I want to speak to you and say to you that you still have time to repent. Don't scoff at me. You still have time to repent. And if you will humble yourself and admit to Jesus Christ, who is the only Savior of the world, that you are a sinner and that you need his salvation, you need his grace, friend, he will forgive you of all of your sin, even what you've done to other people. That's amazing to me, that his grace and his mercy are just basically no bounds. That really his grace and his mercy are infinite, but you will not receive that grace and that mercy if you reject it. And so you have an opportunity to repent of your sin right this minute. I'm going to lead you in a prayer. Maybe you're someone else and you're not guilty of causing people to turn away from Jesus Christ, or basically causing them to be so cynical that they never would even think about coming to him. Maybe you just know that you are not right with God and you need to receive Jesus as your Lord and Savior. The Bible tells us in Acts chapter 4, verse 12, there is salvation in no one else. There is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. And so Jesus has brought you to this place where you have an opportunity to be born again. You have an opportunity to be forgiven of your sin and have a brand new start in life. And you're only a short, simple prayer away from having your sins forgiven and becoming one of his followers. And I'm going to lead you in that prayer right now. Would you pray with me at this moment these words, Lord Jesus Christ? Pray with me. Pray out loud. Lord Jesus Christ, I know that I am a sinner. I know that I have not lived my life for you. I know that I have offended you. I know that I fall short. But I also recognize that you are a God who loves me. You are the God of all grace. You are the God of all mercy. And I believe in you, Lord Jesus. I don't understand. I don't know all there is to know about you. But I know enough now to recognize that no one else can forgive me of my sin except you. And I ask you now, Lord Jesus, to forgive me of my sin. And I will live for you, and I will follow you all the days of my life. Thank you, Lord Jesus, that you have heard my prayer and that you have come in to my heart. And now, friend, if you prayed that prayer, let me pray for you. Father, I pray for all that may have given their lives to Jesus Christ at this moment. I pray that you would protect them from the scoffing and the mocking of the devil, and that you would cause them to hunger and thirst for you and seek you and search for you with all of their hearts. Help them to find an excellent Bible teaching church and to come to know men and women who love you so that they can grow. In your name I pray, Lord Jesus. Amen and amen. Friend, I just want to welcome you into the kingdom of God as a fellow brother or sister in Christ. And one thing I can certainly recommend is that you keep watching these broadcasts, that you get a hold of me and ask me for help and advice, and I can also send you all the teaching that I have to help you to grow in the Christian life. Well, speaking of, again, of Jesus' coming judgment, and the whole idea of weeping and gnashing of teeth, this isn't the only place in Matthew that he's used this phrase. He uses the phrase in Matthew 8, verse 12. He uses the phrase in verse 42 and in verse 50 of Matthew 8. He uses it in Matthew 22, verse 13. He uses it in Matthew 24, verse 51. And he uses it in Matthew 25, verse 30. Listen, with this many repetitions of such an important phrase, it is clear that Jesus is serious about hell and its eternal consequences. He's not railing against anybody. He's warning with a heart of love and compassion. Now, enough Christians in our own day allow emotion to inform their theology instead of truth. And as a result, they wax sympathetic and sentimental about hell, especially as it concerns loved ones who went to their death having persistently rejected Jesus' offer of eternal life. And then these Christians are arrogant enough and foolish enough to then have the audacity to try to change the Word of God to fit the kind of theology that they want. And what they end up doing is they strain to teach a doctrine called annihilationism. And that is that sinners at some point arbitrarily just simply cease to exist. Or they go the other way and teach universalism, that somehow God eventually forgives sinners, whether they want to be forgiven or not, or whether they come through Jesus Christ or not. Frankly, either view is diabolical That is, it's demonic. It's reprehensible. And anyone who teaches those, either one of those, will have serious accountability to the Lord in this life and in the life to come. Now, returning to our text, we also should note the significant contrast between the eternal joy of the righteous in Matthew 13, verse 43, with the eternal agony of the wicked. These are deliberate contrasts that Jesus is giving us. You can see the same thing in Matthew 7, verses 22 through 29, and I encourage you to look up these verses. So if someone were to say, well, someone that rejects Jesus eventually just simply ceases to exist, that is a complete contradiction of what Jesus is teaching. You can't have it both ways. You can't say that Jesus is a good teacher when he's lying. If in fact you're right, then Jesus would be lying. And you can't say that all people, you can't teach universalism, that all people are going to eventually become followers of Jesus, when Jesus plainly teaches that there will be those who reject him and they will suffer eternally. In addition, we observe the encouraging and tender use of the phrase "the kingdom of their father" in verse 43 of Matthew 13. Let's read it. He says, "Then the righteous will shine forth as the sun in the kingdom of their father." And Jesus adds to the verse from Daniel 12, verse 3. What an incredible teaching that we have. And so, loved ones, as we conclude this parable, let us pause and consider again its entire literary context. Remember, it comes immediately after the parable of the sower, which focused on the vast amount of fruit one who is part of the kingdom could bring forth. This parable is intended to show Jesus' disciples that our fruit bearing is not without obstacles and challenges. Moreover, lest his disciples imagine that the kingdom would immediately come with power and their enemies would be vanquished, Jesus teaches them that the fullness of the kingdom would most certainly not come in their lifetime. Instead, these last days that we're living in would involve a major challenge for all of his followers, since the enemy will also be at work to attempt to destroy our Lord's works. And therefore, all of his disciples must be warned in advance. You know, I think about what's happening throughout the Muslim world, where when Muslims repent and give their life to Jesus, they're quickly, if they're found out, they're executed, and they're persecuted severely. There's no freedom of religion in Muslim countries if you're a Christian. So friend, I just want to ask you, are you heeding Jesus' sober teaching and warning about the challenges of following him in this age? And finally, we end on an encouraging note. This parable is an assurance that despite the ambiguity of present experience, the kingdom of God is at work and it will ultimately triumph. And this is an encouragement. It's a great encouragement when we're tempted to be depressed by the power of evil in the world and all that we see around us, and by the frailty of the church and in our own personal experience. The kingdom of God will triumph. The kingdom of God suffers in this age, but justice will ultimately prevail, and Jesus Christ will have his way. Let me stop and pray for you right now. Father, thank you for this person and these people that have been watching this video. I pray for all those who have been watching this, and myself included, that you would produce within us a greater hunger and thirst for you, greater reverence for your word, greater fruit in our lives, greater humility, and greater patience in the midst of this fallen, evil world that we live in. And we pray, Maranatha, come quickly, Lord Jesus. In your name we ask, amen and amen. Well, God bless you. I look forward to seeing you next time as I teach more on the parables of Jesus Christ. This is Pastor Brad Abley teaching my ministry, A Heart After God Bible Teaching Ministry. And if you would like to contribute to this ministry, I make my living by the gospel. I could use your help as I do more and more teaching, especially to people in Africa. It would help me to make more trips overseas to Kenya and other parts of Africa as well. Just go to my website, PastorBradAbley.weebly.com, and there will be giving instructions there on how you can support my ministry. It's actually through Empowered Living International Ministries. Empowered Living International Ministries. So all you'd have to do is you can write a check to Empowered Living International Ministries, and or you could give online as well. Well, may the Lord bless you greatly. We'll see you next time.